Last time, we proved one of the hardest results about topological manifolds, namely, if any subspace of Rn is locally contractible, then it is a local retract. This was the theorem. So we shall use that one now for a manifold which is inside Rn. By the very nature, manifold is locally Euclidean, that means it's locally contractible. And by embedding theorems, partly which we are assuming that every manifold is a subspace of Rn, some n. Therefore, combining these two, we can do some homotopical aspects of the topology of an arbitrary manifold itself. So let us take care of that one now. So this is the first thing that we derive. X be any topological manifold, then it is a retract of a locally finite countable CW complex of some finite pure dimension n. Moreover, if X is compact, then W can be chosen to be finite. Okay, so this is the basic theorem that we can derive it from whatever we have done previously. Start with an embedding of X in R capital N for some n. Take a neighborhood U of X and a retraction R from U to X. So this is what the earlier theorem allows us. In fact, that theorem was more elaborate. Only weaker version of that we are using. There is a neighborhood, and that neighborhood and a retraction is there. That's all I'm using here. Now, go back to the CW complex structure of those given by those lattice structures. That will be used again. Let A prime be the collection of all n cells in P which intersect X and which are contained in U. If an n cell is too big, we don't want them. They must be contained inside the open subset U and they must intersect X. If they are far away, we don't want them. Okay, so that is a collection A prime. From this A prime, delete all members which are contained in some other member already. Once a big cube is taken, no smaller cell will be taken inside that one. It's only for capital N cells, okay? The surfaces, etc. will be taken, of course. So delete all those members of P which are contained in some other members of that one. Then this will qualify for being a what? Locally finite CW complex. So let's put W equal to W of A, basically union of all these. So this W is different from the W of the previous theorem, by the way. Don't confuse that with W. That W was Rn minus X. Here it is. It is a neighborhood of X now. Then X is contained inside this WA, which is W, and it's contained inside U because all constitutions, all N cells which are which make W are contained inside U. So this is by definition, we have this one. Okay, and what is more, if there is a retraction from U to X, it's already there, we can restrict that one to WA to get a retraction from W to X. Okay, and our previous lemma tells you that all the required properties of W, namely it is a countable, right? So whatever you have, locally finite countable CW complex of pure dimension n means what? All the cells are contained inside an n cell. So that is obvious because we have started with all these n cubes and then taken their subspace, faces also. That is what it is. Okay, so all these things are there for this WA. Okay, from the local finiteness, it follows that W is finite if X is compact. Once X is compact, for each point there is a neighborhood at which only finitely many cells will intersect, but if you cover X with finitely many of these, only finitely many N cells will intersect it. Anything which does not intersect X, so automatically this W will be finite by the very choice if X is compact. Okay, so this big theorem now comes very easily because of the previous theorem, that hard work we have done. Now, an interesting corollary is that the fundamental group, homology groups of any manifold, they are all countable. If X is compact, they will be finitely generated also. Okay? So what is the proof? Proof is very straightforward. From the theorem, we have a retraction R from W to X. If I from X to W is inclusion map, what we have? Retraction means what? R composite I is identity of X. Passing to the fundamental group level, R check composite I check will be identity check. Okay, at the fundamental group level. What is that? Pi 1 of xx naught goes to pi 1 of wx naught under the inclusion induced map, and this is R check comes back to pi 1 of xx naught. Okay, in particular, this R check will be surjective. Okay, this whole thing is identity mapping, this must be surjective. Okay, but W is what? W is a countable CW complex. Countable CW complex has countably many generators for pi 1. Okay, only you have to look at the one skeleton of that. All right, any group which generated over a countable set is itself countable. Therefore, pi 1 of W is countable, is a surjective homomorphism, so pi 1 of X is also countable. Okay, the next part, suppose X is compact, then we have seen that W can be chosen to be a finite CW complex. Therefore, its one skeleton is finite. Therefore, there are only finitely many generators. Okay, since this is surjective map again, X pi 1 of X will be also finitely generated. Okay. So this is about the fundamental group. The argument is ditto for homology group as well. Okay, ditto. If you, instead of pi 1, if you put h 1 here, h star for all h star to h star of x to h star of w to h star, the same argument will work. Yeah. So the homology group of a manifolds are finitely are countable and finitely generated if it is compact. It's finitely generated as a module, okay? Therefore, it cannot go on in infinitely many dimensions also, okay? But that was there, we had got if X is a CW complex structure. But here we have, we won't have X itself doesn't have a CW complex. What we had here is there is a retraction. It's like W is dominating X. So you should be happy that we have proved some very, very handful, I mean, a result which on which we can lay our hands, huh? Okay. So here are a few examples for you, I mean, exercises for you, which you can try out. Of course, always there will be a team of members who will help you out. Now let us go to the next topic. Let us begin that topic of classification of one-dimensional manifold. It will be again a sufficiently lengthy topic. So this is again another very useful and on which we can put our hands and you know that we have learned something. So more generally, let us look at any classification problem in science. First of all, what do? We have to collect samples, okay, plenty of them. And when we are sure, oh, we have got all sort of varieties, we feel that, oh, this must be covering all possible varieties, all possible objects. That is the meaning of that one. Only after that, we go for a systematic, classification as such. Namely, what do you mean by this belongs to this class? What is the meaning of something is connected? What is the meaning of something is compact and so on, just like that. What is the meaning of, you know, protozoa? What is the meaning of, and so on? You know, you had this biological, in biology classes, you had all these phylums, no? That's why, that's the similar one. Even biology was studied in this way. Or classification, okay. So the final step will be that you should determine all possible mutually different types, mutual different classes, all possible. In the run for that, you may find that you have not corrected some kind of thing. There must be something like this. This is what you search for, such a search. What you mean by search? Such a scientific study always leads to the search. Just like how the classification of elements was completed. Okay, so when you systematically do that, you will see that there are certain missing items here. There must be something missing here. So you search for it and then you find that, yeah, it is there. That kind of thing is also possible. Okay. So for any, now coming back to any manifold, okay, is locally connected and hence its connected components are all open as well as closed. Therefore, every manifold is actually, as a topological space, the disjoint union of its connected components. Therefore, studying connected manifolds is enough. Why? Because then you can put disjoint, as topologically, the other things are just disjoint union of these things. So each one you have to study connectivity. You can put the connectivity. Okay. Quite often, we put the compactness, and that is not for completeness. There is no way of actually reducing the general classification to compact spaces. This is only for technical reasons, so that things become somewhat easier for us. Okay. So right now, as far as one-dimensional manifold is concerned, we are only putting connectivity condition. That's all. Okay, so what are examples of one dimensional connected manifolds we have. Okay, you have to collect them first, samples. So you can take any open subset of R, they are manifolds, R itself is one. Any open subset, again, I want to take connected, so they are only intervals. But now there are different kinds of intervals. Open interval, half closed intervals, and closed intervals. And that is the end of all types of connected one manifolds inside R. Right? So we would like to go, by the way, what do you mean by all of them? Now, within this class, you take any two open intervals, we know that they are homeomorphic to each other, whether finite or infinite. If it's one half closed, then it will be always homeomorphic to any other half closed interval. If it's a closed interval, any other closed interval will be homeomorphic to this closed interval. This much we know already. Actually, we have all these things linear isomorphism. From finite to infinite, we have even the map x going to tan x also. X going to tan x gives you the homeomorphism from minus pi by 2, comma pi by 2 to the whole of R. So with these kind of things equipped ourselves, we are sure that there are only three types of manifolds, connected one-dimensional manifolds inside R. Open interval, half-closed intervals, and closed intervals. Okay. Right? Once you go out of R, just go to R2, there are many other kinds of things, namely all conic sections will come. Circle, ellipse, hyperbola, parabola, and so on, right? The pair of lines, of course, if they are parallel, then they are manifolds, but that is just the case which you have already considered. Any line is homeomorphic to the real line. There is no problem. The circle is quite different. Circle is a different type. Okay, you can rigorously prove that. There are many other. Right now, you feel that it is true, then we pass on. We have to just collect now. Right now, we are collecting. Ellipse is not a different object. Geometrically, yes, but topologically, ellipse and circle are homeomorphic to each other. Triangle, no problem. It is again homeomorphic to circle. Square, any polygon, convex polygon, boundary of a convex polygon is homeomorphic to a circle. Okay, hyperbola is not connected. You have to take one lap and then it is like a line. Okay, it may be curved, but it is homeomorphic to a line. Okay, so this way we can keep on collecting, but we don't know anything more. Even if you go to R3, R4, you know, you may have very twisted things and so on, but we don't know whether there are any different types of manifolds. So at this stage, we would like to ask whether we have really reached the end, dead end. Okay, so do we get any other types of one-dimensional manifolds? If we look for them inside R3, R4, Rn, and so on, where to look for them? We don't have to look outside because any topological manifold is a subspace of Rn. That result we have already proved. In fact, everything will be inside some R3. Beyond R3, you don't have to look. Because one-dimensional manifold, by the theorem of which we haven't proved, of course, yet, is embeddable inside R3. Okay? So here is a surprising and pleasant answer that we have exhausted the list. Okay, the answer is no, there are no more of them. So here is a statement of the theorem which we would like to prove. While proving, we may get some other insight, and then we may find a new element. So that is possible, of course. So this is the way conjecture. So this is what, that's the way conjectures are made. This is what we want to prove. What is that? Let X be a connected one-dimensional manifold. Hausdorff and second countability is in our back of our mind. Okay. Remember that those two conditions are there. Okay. So here I am stating even for smooth case also, but you can ignore that. Okay, right now. So take topological manifold. Then X is homeomorphic to one of the following. What are these? Open interval 0, 1, half closed interval 0, 1, closed interval 0, 1, or the circle S1. That's it. So there are only four types. One can see that each of these type is a different type. They are themselves not homeomorphic to each other. If they are, then I won't put them in the list. I will cut down my list. The problem is that this list is complete. Why there is not a fifth element here? That is the hardest thing to prove. Okay. So in particular, what does this mean? Boundary of X is empty. Suppose boundary of X is empty, along with it's a connected one-dimensional manifold. Boundary of X is empty here and empty here. But for the 2 and 3, it is not. Right? So boundary of X is empty, it means X is homeomorphic to open interval 0, 1 or the circle. If this theorem is true. Suppose we just prove this part, not using this list, okay? Not using this list. Suppose we just prove this part, namely that any manifold, one-dimensional connected manifold without boundary is homeomorphic to open interval or the circle. Then we can complete the proof of what happens if the boundary X is non-empty. So other two will come. So what I'm tell you is that proving this list will be, you know, the task of proving this one will be halved by this one. Instead of four of them, I have to just look at the one and four. I have to only classify them. Okay, so how? Let me see that. Suppose we assume this part that one and four are the only elements if X is boundaryless. Then take the boundary, take a manifold, one-dimensional connected manifold with the boundary. Its interior is again a one-dimensional connected manifold without boundary this time. Therefore, the interior must be either 0, 1 or the circle S1. Do you agree? So, can the circle S1 be the interior of a manifold with boundary? So that is what you have to see. Okay, and what happens to that, if at all? So it follows the interior of X cannot be homeomorphic to S1. Why? Because then it will be a compact subset of X. Okay, and hence S1 will be closed inside X, but boundary points are close in the closure, so all the boundary points will be inside S1, but then S1 will not be the interior, so that's a contradiction. Okay, so S1, if it's contained inside some, then it will be disconnected. So S1 itself is closed as well as open. That is the whole idea. Okay, so the other one, 0, 1. 0, 1 can be the interior of some closed manifold. Yes, of course, you just look at this list itself tells you. close 0, 1, 0 close, take the open interval, that is the interior. Here also, 0, 1 open interval is the interior of 0, 1. 1, 1 and 0 are the boundary points. What we want to say that is, these are the only two cases now. Can there be another point? There is one point in the boundary, this is the case. It could be 0 and 1 closed. But 0, 1 closed is homeomorphic to 0 closed 1 by reflecting around the half. Okay. So the second case is, there are two points, 0 as well as 1, and the boundary. That is this case. Can there be a third point? That is a question. Okay. So it can be very easily seen that you can't have a third point as an interior point, as a boundary point of this one. Why? Because once 0, 1 is there, similar to S1, that itself will be compact and it is a closed subset of X, the manifold X that we are looking for. Okay, a third point which is outside 0, 1, closed 0, 1, if it is a closure, if it is in the boundary, then it must be in the closure of this, but it must be 0, 1 itself. Same argument which we use for S1. Once 0, 1, the closure is there, it cannot have any more boundary points. So that completes the picture that these must be all the four of them. So we have to only classify manifolds, connected one-dimensional manifolds, which are boundaryless. So that is the gist of the argument, slightly different argument here, using, you know, Hausdorffness. But you don't need to reference, you say compact Hausdorff. If you have a compact subset of a Hausdorff space, then it's a closed subset. That's what I have used. So there is a slightly different way I have put it without compactness. So this kind of argument also we will use later. I think we will stop here now and proceed with the classification next time. Okay, we have just made a proposition and what we have to do. Next time, we will continue with this one. Thank you.